Welcome once again to QI, the reality show where four people are held in a queue until one of them becomes interesting. Clive Anderson. Phil Kay. Johnny Sessions. And Alan Davis. Now, first of all, you have a special project, members of the team, and that is to draw and colour in, if you so choose, a wigwam.
And as this is Series B...
We'd like you to do it in the style of artists, beginning with B. So, Clive, if you do it in the style of Botticelli.
Ah, yes.
Phil, in the style of William Blake. Johnny, you're rather good at drawing, so in the style of Braque.
Braque, OK.
And, Alan, I don't need to tell you that you'll be Bosch. So, that's your task.
Anonymous Bosch.
Painted scenes of hell.
Did he?
Yeah. You don't really have to do it in the style. Any old wigwam will do.
Any old wigwam.
Really?
Yes, go on.
Thank God. I didn't know what I was going to do then.
Now, in case you need to be excused, you need to attract my attention. Clive does it like this. And Phil does it like this. And Johnny does it like this.
Oh, I know, sir. Sir, please, sir, I know.
Oh. Alan does it like this. Well, I'm glad that you went before you came. Now, you all know me.
Yeah.
I'm one of those Johnny jump up, meet me in the corner and tickle my fancy types. Right? Mm. So what am I?
Sir, I know, sir.
You're the sacked lyricist for Lindisfarne. Because those were the original lyrics for Meet Me on the Corner, that hit of 1972.
That sounds like it.
Yes.
You're a hoarder of many hyphens.
I am a hoarder of many hyphens.
You've almost got them all. Yeah.
I can add that I'm also a love idol.
Are these fishing flies at all?
They're not fishing flies.
Are they roses?
I'm also a meet me in the buttery. Or kiss me in the buttery, occasionally called.
Are they types of flowers?
They are. All one type of flower, also known as pink of my John. I'm not making it up.
Carnations.
No.
Tulips.
No. Johnny Pinks. Might get it because there's a Shakespearean reference. The flower, yes, that men do call love in idleness.
Ah, yes. Some dead men's fingers call.
It's in Romeo and Juliet.
No. The Dream.
The Dream.
The Midsummer Night's Dream. Yes.
Come back, you will float it up like in a balloon above it.
All right. Yeah. So it's a flower, it's called Kiss Me in the Buttery, Jump Up Jack, Tickle My Fancy, Love in Idleness, Heartsease, Pink My John.
Oh, yes.
And Dale Winton.
So what am I if I'm all those things? I am a
pansy.
Yes! I am a wild pansy.
You are.
And there are more folk names for the wild pansy than for every other flower. The word pansy actually comes from the French pensée, as a thought.
Yes.
Or an idea. Because they're supposedly good for the memory.
Pansies. Eating them, can you
eat them? Yes, indeed. A refreshing tea, which is supposed to be good for the complexion and clearing phlegm, made from pansies.
And yet Pascal's book, Pansies, didn't sell very well, did it?
No, it didn't. No. It didn't. No. One person in the audience knows that Blaise Pascal wrote a book called Pansies.
Sir, I know, sir.
Yes, there were 200 at the last count, 200 names for the wild pansy.
God.
That was, of course, a question about botany. So your next question is, what is bottomry?
It's the opposite of topiary. Topiary is that thing where you take...
Very good.
You take a... topiary is, as you will know, Steve, you take a tree or a bush or whatever...
Yes.
..and you shape it into a beautiful shape.
Absolutely.
You do. An animal or something like that.
Yes.
Well, bottom is the opposite thing. When you see a tree, well, that looks a bit like a horse or something, and then you cut it back to look like a wild tree. It's not much fun, to be honest.
Sir, I know, sir.
There's another argument for it, that it's the website in Tokyo for all the Japanese men who are crazy about Virginia Bottomley.
And, they go, Bottomley! 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 Yes. Would it help you if I said the bottom is exactly the same thing as bottomage?
Oh, I know what this is. Was it in France or was it somewhere, Droit de Seigneur, when the sort of local lord had a right to have his evil way with any girl or milkmaid in the village? Well, if you were a minor sort of lord or a baron or something, you had a right of bottomry, which was just you could just slap them on the bottom. That was all your entitlement. No more than that. In a nice way, if there is such a thing, which I deplore. And I would, no, these days, absolutely forbidden.
No, bottom being a ship in this case.
A ship.
It's a sort of mortgage, really. You mortgage the ship in order to raise money to go off on a trading voyage or merchant ventures.
Yeah, they call it ships bottoms, don't they?
Ships are called bottoms in the marine commerce world.
Of course, there's a line in Henry V, one of the chorus, before they set off for France, where Shakespeare talks about them drawing their bottoms through the water. He's referring to the ships, not to the soldiers.
Excellent. Yeah. Now, next question, then. So, what did Buffalo Bill do to buffaloes?
Sir, I know, sir.
I don't actually know the answer to this, but what I do know is that my grandmother was born in 1875, and she saw Buffalo Bill and Annie
down
Oakley...
The shop.
But she might have done and not been aware of the fact...
She saw his Wild West show, did
she? She saw his Wild West show at the Kelvin Hall in 1892.
That's the sound of an arrow hurtling towards another. I hope I've got the right drift on this, because I think I can see a trap on this.
Yes.
The American buffalo isn't, strictly speaking, a buffalo. It's a bison.
Yeah, right.
So he did nothing with the...
Yeah, absolutely. There, so. Spot on, indeed. They are the... He should have been called Bison Bill.
Yes.
They're not buffaloes, or even related to the two kinds of buffalo that exist.
But at a sort of philosophical level, which I know you like to operate at, if something is called...
I agree.
If they are called buffalo, it's like the Bayeux tapestry, strictly speaking, isn't a tapestry.
Yeah.
But it's the only tapestry, or thing, it was embroidery, really, but it's the only one we've ever heard of. So if you say, well, that isn't a tapestry, then it's a loser. So these are the only buffalo we've ever come across, and they're not
buffalo. Apart from water buffalo, if you're in the
water
in
buffalo,
Asia,
or in Africa you see buffalo.
In Africa you see buffalo.
My wigwam is
a bison's got two humps. I was in the city of Buffalo when I heard of the death of Elvis Presley.
Well, it should have been the city of bison.
It should have been.
Yes, there's a buffalo and a bison.
That's a buffalo on the right.
Look how low its ears are, really low down.
Aren't they?
Yes. Look, they're well below the eyes.
It likes
right
to keep,
by the nose.
It likes to keep its ears close to the ground.
Its ears are there.
Why is the one on the right wearing an advocate's wig?
Yeah.
But he killed a load of them.
He killed an astonishing number. In 18 months,
Buffalo
he killed 4,280 bison.
Yes.
Or buffalo. Well, he used to work for the Pony Express as a boy. And this is a rather good letter, or rather advertisement the Pony Express
Arkell
took out.
Arkell used to write for that.
this is the ad. Wanted, young, skinny, wiry fellows, not over 18. Must be expert riders willing to risk death daily.
You wrote that.
It goes on. Orphans preferred. Wages $25 a week. But anyway, that only lasted 19 months, the Pony Express, because of the railways. And the Kansas Pacific Railway needed food for its workers, and so they employed Buffalo Bill to kill bison, or buffalo as they call them, to feed the construction crews for the railway.
But in dances with wolves, they just kill buffalo for fun.
Well, the Native Americans, the Indians, whatever you prefer to call them, they used to lure them over cliffs, which was their way of killing a lot. They used their hides and they used their meat, so it's not as if they killed them.
But they'd
just
only lure exactly the right number that they actually needed to feed the tribe.
No, they didn't. They don't have that sentimental view of them as if we're nasty human beings, but all Native American tribes are peace-loving philosophers.
We were all, drunk and badly behaved. They'd never lure a pregnant one over.
The way they lured them over was to cause them to stampede, and once they're stampeding, they all go.
No, when they had enough, then they'd go over and go, "Hey, that's stop!"
it was that moment when, when's the stampede over? You know, you're stampeding, and then you're not stampeding. You know, that nice...
When you've hit the ground at the end of the cliff, then you know it's over.
Stampede's finished.
If you're at the front of the stampede, you've got to keep stampeding, because everyone behind stampeding. If you stop, straight over...
May I assist come to the aid of the hippie party here? Because although these buffaloes, or bison, they live quite happily with the American Indians eating a few of them, killing a few of them. And then they were got rid of, and they replaced them with cows. And the cows have caused, you know, a dust bowl in that part of America.
Oh, no.
Twice now. Yeah. But now they're discovering the only thing that can really satisfactorily live there are these bison. So they're reintroducing bison.
And crossing them with cattle, in fact.
Well, what do they get up to in their private life?
From 60 million bison in the 17th century, they went to just a few hundred in the late 19th century. They're now about 50,000. I'll read out the next question. Buffalo Bill's famous Wild West show included a famous Native American chief, Sitting Bull, Sitting Buffalo Bull, who, of course, defeated Custer at the Battle of Little Bighorn. But what was his real name? Do you know?
Bison. It worked for the last question. Well, they're always named after the first thing that the squaw sees.
Two dogs.
I was going to let the audience think that for themselves. Buffalo Bill, although he had to kill thousands of buffalo or bison in order to acquire that nickname of Buffalo to go with the rather dull name Bill. So, but old Sitting Bull, all he had to do was sit around a lot. Talk, you know,
bulls
rubbish like this.
Sit. Do they?
Ferdinand?
Ferdinand the Bull.
You know, oh, yes, so he was...
He used to sit under the cork tree smelling the flowers.
And then a bee got into it.
He got stung by a bee and then he was...
Yeah.
What? It's a book. It's a book that you happen not to have read. It doesn't make us mad because...
Because the bee stung him, he ran around like crazy and they thought, oh, he's a fine bull. Then they got into the bull ring or whatever.
It's a children's classic. It's a very beautiful book.
What's it called?
Ferdinand the Bull.
Ferdinand forgets to take his drugs test and is disqualified.
From the bullfight.
Exactly.
But bulls sit down when it's going to rain, don't they?
Yes, supposedly.
Yes,
they have
a dry patch.
If you like.
Well, Standing Cow, he was called.
Actually, he was called Jumping Badger. That was his given name. He acquired his father's name when he was a teenager. His father was Sitting Bull. And because he'd done great exploits, he'd killed his first buffalo stroke bison at the age of 10. And then he took part in a raiding party on a Crow-Indian settlement, which is a great hero, and his father gave him his name, Sitting Bull. His mother was called Her Holy Door.
Interesting. There were rubbish of names in that family. Right? Sitting Bull was scarcely okay, but Jumping Badger. Why, Dad?
Why am I called
There was a film character who was very popular with your mother.
Now, who made Pots and Pots from Bill and Ben? From Bill and Ben.
Sir, I know, sir. Yes.
I think it's somebody like, dare one say.
You do Bill and Ben now.
Yeah. Is it someone like Greg Dyke or Michael Grade?
Well, yeah, in fact.
Yeah.
Do you know?
I don't know who it was, but I mean, Greg Dyke did the rat thing, didn't he? So he
Roland Rat.
Oh, he did indeed.
So that's a good guess, I'd say.
It's simply that the BBC have, of late, made £2 million from video sales of Bill and Ben, and they paid the creator, Hilda Wright, the magnificent sum of three guineas for the whole thing, which is three original radio stories. She named Bill and Ben after her own brothers, younger
say
brothers.
Breasts, then.
I think the wish
suffered enough. This woman.
Breasts do kind of go flop on, I suppose. And when they were naughty, the mother would say, "Oh, something bad had happened in the house. Was it Bill or was it Ben?" And that, of course, was the catchphrase of the programme. Was it Bill or was it Ben? And the little sister Phyllis was weed. The voice of Bill and Ben, in a language which is called Flobbadob, was a man called Peter Hawkins, who went on to great fame as both a Dalek and a Cyberman. In 1999, he apparently was associate producer on a programme called The Lifestyle, Group Sex in the Suburbs.
That's where I remember him from then, yes.
But where did this language Flobbadob come from? It was their nickname for the sound a fart made in the bath.
Ah!
It literally was a flubberdob. Now, what does Billy the Kid have in common with Ben Hur?
Bill. Capital B.
I can't really fault you on that.
They have me in common. I know them both. I've been to where Billy the Kid was shot and I've seen Ben Hur.
Ben Hur's in the Scottish Highlands, isn't it? Ben Hur. It's in that, the Hollywood range. Ben Affleck, yeah. Glenn Close is nearby. They're all up there.
Do you know who wrote Ben Hur?
Gore Vidal claims to. Yes.
Oh, no, he wrote the screenplay of the film. Mm. Who wrote the novel?
When was it written?
It was written in 1880, or published in 1880.
In America?
In the United States of America.
Someone thought, sitting about and thought, I'm going to write Book about Roman chariot racing.
Yeah. What should you have written about? You shouldn't tell anyone. Yeah. You're writing a book about something that's not particularly close to you. Yeah. You wanker! Shakespeare writing about Romans.
Well, it's...
Sure.
It's not only about chariot racing, to take another point. There's a lot of other stuff in it.
It's about Christianity, it's about loyalty and betrayal and friendship and all kinds of things. But anyway.
Leprosy. Yeah. It's all the phrase, what are you really angry about?
No. The man was called Lew Wallace, who wrote the novel, and he was governor of New Mexico. His connection with Billy the Kid is that he also wrote Billy the Kid's death warrant.
So while he was being governor of New Mexico, he was able to write a best-selling... Yes.
Yeah. It was a warm morning in Rome.
What's all that? What's all that?
Sir, I know, sir.
I thought there's one other thing that just I think is interesting, and it involves a staggeringly hideous name drop. I was at the Sundance Film Festival a few years ago, where I had my great good luck to have supper with Robert Redford. And...
it's a special little forfeit for Johnny. Yeah. It's the lovey alarm.
Exactly.
But carry on. You were having because dinner with
Robert. I told my very close and personal Bobberty is what he prefers.
Bobberty Bedford.
Bobberty. And as I was toweling him down after our bracing game of shuttlecock, I happened to mention to him that the Sundance Kid, I don't know if any of you know this, was in fact Welsh. Well, the family's stock was certainly
good. This town ain't big enough for the brother. Yeah.
He's right stuck up, that Billy the Kid. He's going to come to no good.
Now, to Bill Deans, what happens to your thoughts when you go upstairs?
Gravitationally, I mean, of course, the pressure changes. Your blood varies in its aspect and its circulatory aspect, so your brain becomes less fueled by the blood affected by altitude and therefore become less... clever, and hence hostesses tea, coffee, coffee, tea.
That's a very good answer indeed. Deep physics.
Deep physics.
Deep, deep, deep sort of real theoretical physics.
Your thoughts are and when the gravity allowed is... to float upwards. They go upwards, suck downwards, they suck downwards. They go upwards. You start thinking about physics when you get these.
The answer is they run faster. Everything is faster. You breathe faster, your metabolism is faster, because time is slower the weaker the gravity. Now, talking of going upstairs in buildings, what is the best floor of a building out of which to throw a cat? Blimey, yeah. That's impressive.
Lovely mahogany.
A mahogany floor is the best floor. It's the best story of a building, with an E.
It's only a guess. Yeah. I'm guessing, but I reckon it must be about the fifth floor, something like that, because if it's too... Assuming you're trying to do the cat some harm, which I object to, but if you want to kill the cat, if that's the idea, if it was only the first floor, it would survive because they're very springy animals. And if you go too far up, I'm guessing they form a sort of parachute with and they'd float down. But like the fifth floor would be about right, and they'd be still hurtling, and the parachute effect wouldn't come in.
Yeah, absolutely right. But the fact is, we don't want to harm them, we want to be nice to them, them to survive.
Oh, well, the very, very high floor, then.
Well, the seventh. Anything higher than the seventh. They experimented by studying, not by throwing cats out of the window. They studied 132 cases of cats falling out of windows in New York. This is the American Veterinary Center. 132 cases of
or
cats
were they
falling or being pushed out of windows and surviving. And the injury rate went up. The average was the average was from about the fifth floor.
God.
And the higher up you went towards the fifth floor, the more injuries there were. But the moment you got to seven and past seven, the fewer injuries there were. Because they can reach a terminal velocity, which is 60 miles an hour, from whatever floor, from an aeroplane, cats have survived. And like a squirrel, they spread themselves out and parachute, as it were, parachute.
Like a squirrel.
Onto the sixth floor window, they haven't got time to get to that terminal speed and to get the position right. Exactly.
Have they done this? Have they done this with other animals? Have they done hamsters, dogs?
I'm not sure.
Like cows. I'd like to see them do cows.
I fear somehow these cows... There's a man in Shropshire who catapults cows. Yeah. He puts them on a catapult and flies them through the air, hundreds and hundreds of yards.
Does that not harm
dead cows?
Oh, dead cows.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
But I would urge people at home not to try it with your cat if you're a young person.
No.
Not because it isn't valuable and scientific, but because of the mad letters I get from cat people every time. Do not throw your cats off anything or off a wall or not. They're, they're just let them be.
Or at least not from lower than the seventh.
That's the idea. So, general ignorance. What is the commonest material in the world?
Jim Davidson's.
Very good indeed.
You must have a real answer.
No, I can't better that. That was it.
Oxygen.
Yeah, I'm talking about material that's a substance.
What did I say?
Oh, dear.
Oxygen.
Did you say oxygen? Oh, yeah.
Damn.
Substance, material, matter.
Water.
I think it's just matter.
It's perovskite.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh,
darn it.
God, that was, written down as well.
That was on the tip of my tongue.
Named after Count Lev Perovsky. A mineralogist. It's a mineral compound of magnesium, silicon and oxygen and accounts for about half the total mass of the planet. It's what the Earth's mantle is mostly made from, or so scientists suppose.
So he reckoned he was going to be famous by giving his name to the most common stuff, and we've
no one's ever heard of it.
He's got such a good name for a scientist who discovered things, and probably had a wonderful accent, just the same as the man who used to go, "Incredible, Tyrannosaurus Rex."
And he said Heinz Wolf.
Yes, yeah, so yeah. It's like Heinz Wolf, exactly.
It's a very elegant solution to my problem. Yes. It's always you know, it's, it's all the same case. But a little bow tie was yes.
Yes.
Now, what happened to Pompeii in 63 AD? His eyes narrow.
Ah, yes.
I've been to Vesuvius.
Have you? Yes. What happened to Pompeii?
I'm really trying to remember really, really hard. Is there a time limit? I can't remember if that's when it got covered in lava and everyone died.
It was an earthquake they had before.
Quite right, it was the earthquake. Yeah. It was destroyed by an earthquake and they had just started to rebuild it when 12, 14 years later...
Oh, I bet the air was
79
blue.
79
AD. Just finished it. Can't believe it. It's all finished.
Yeah. The air was actually black.
Oh, the tiles. I just put the tiles up.
Yes, one of the things that was preserved, they showed almost every household had an extraordinary number of pots of plaster because they were replastering all the houses.
Artexing the inside.
Artexing the inside. Expecting another
There's earthquake. A hole, there's a bit of it you can walk across which has got a sulphur crust, which is about that thick. And the places where it's fallen through.
Is this type of pizza?
And it's going... and it's going bloop, bloop, big bubbles. Bloop, and there are fences around, and you go across in your school party, and they say, go in pairs, not in big clusters, because you might go through. And don't... They say to you... They say this to school party from Essex, don't jump up and down.
Oh, what a mistake! Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. They never heard of reverse psychology.
What did you say that for? This is a kid's at back. Certain death.
Oh, lordy lord.
So it's going to go again, is it? It's about to
it's really overdue.
Mm, massively overdue.
Can you imagine you know, being an estate agent trying to sell a house and then there's lava coming to what? You know, imagine how good you'd have to be to sell all the house, even though there's.
Here's the keys, thank you very much.
Yeah. For a quick sale.
It's not central heating, it's exterior.
Didn't the Phoenicians end, the actual Phoenician civilization ended the same way?
It's a volcano, we're finished.
But while still in Rome, how did Roman emperors order the death of a gladiator?
My thumbs are...
No, well, no, you're right. It was a trap. No, they didn't put their thumbs down. Put their thumbs up.
Take him out and kill him.
Well, this is a...
Hey, gladiator! It is over for you!
It's all a joke about whether it's up or down, but it's life and death to some poor gladiator.
Yes, exactly, they ought to know. I mean, in films,
why
right?
Why do they go like that in the films, then?
Well, because we have this up and down idea, and...
So when we go like that, we mean... Death to you!
So what was the saving symbol? What was the... what did they have one?
It was called pollex compressus, where you'd put the thumb, the pollex, in that way, as
they
opposed
put little,
to
little
pollex infestus.
Little mouth and eyes on as well. Is it?
Right now, even to this day, though, this is that's the rudest thing you can do in Sicily.
Oh, is it?
Which is why so many hitchhikers are killed. Seriously. You stand by the road going like that, people just going...
Yeah. Russell Crowe, he's going for the knob there, isn't he?
Yeah, he is.
He's going to bite it off.
And what he's holding is his gladius. Gladius. Yes. Which is why they're called gladiators. It's a small, flattish sword.
Now, were the Romans really the only people who had that kind of men killing each other for sport?
It's a very interesting question. I've never heard of it in the Chinese culture.
The Greeks didn't do it, did they?
The Greeks didn't do it, no. They had naked wrestling instead, which is much more the thing. Now, what was the name of the organisation that the Americans fought in Vietnam? In
the Viet Cong, the Gooks.
You want the proper name of the organisation?
Alan, even I can work out that when you know the answer, never give it, because it's always the one, it's the one they're hoping we'll say. It's
Gooks and Charlie and Viet Cong are all alike made up by Americans. The word Viet Cong doesn't exist. It was made up by the CIA.
Vietnamese Popular Army. Liberation Front.
Yes, which was known as the...
Vietnamese Popular
PLO,
Army.
PLO, PLF, Tooting Popular Front.
The Viet... the name of their great hero.
Ho Chi Minh.
Ho Chi Minh. Viet Minh.
The Viet Minh. Ah,
yes. You will have heard of this before. The Americans gave a huge amount of money to the Viet Minh because at one point they were on the same side.
Who have never heard this happening.
No.
This is ridiculous.
And then having armed them to the teeth, the war then ends, and again, a huge historical surprise here, the French surrender, extraordinary, to Ho Chi Minh in 1954, and that's the end of their rule in Indochina. And suddenly the Americans are fighting them with the weapons they gave them just 10 years earlier.
But what is this term, Viet Cong? Is that supposed to be a term of abuse, like King Kong?
Yes,
or something?
CIA believed it sounded more kind of menacing and ugly and also associated with communism. It was a Viet Cong.
But Viet Minh doesn't sound very good.
Hello, why? You want slippy? No.
I'm sorry, I'm a missionary.
Is there a nationality that hasn't been cruelly abused in the course of this?
No, it's
lampoon. It seems not.
So was King Kong, was that his real name, or was it really King Minh?
Oddly enough, the Danish for king is Kong, so in Denmark the film is called Kong King.
Kong King.
It is called Kong King. Yes, it's time to hold up your work, please.
Look at my buffalo.
Good buffalo.
I remember.
There's a wigwam. There's Johnny's. And it's a cubist wigwam. Genuine ooze and ours.
I misunderstood. I've got wham wigs. This is George Michael and Richie, and they're wearing wigs. What's wrong with that?
Very good indeed. Very good. And what have we got there?
This is William Blake's, you know, God, but God is a white man with a holster on, man, yeah. Ah. And the tiny wigwam. These are the red Indians, that's the blue Indian, that's the beige Indian. And this is thunder and stuff. You know.
It's William. Very apocalyptic. I'm sorry that nobody did a wigwam, though.
A wigwam.
No, that's not a wigwam.
That's a wigwam.
Is that a teepee?
That's a teepee. You've got
What's the difference between a teepee and a wigwam?
I'll show you a picture of a wigwam. That's a wigwam.
Oh, wow.
They're very different. That's a wigwam.
It's a haystack. And they were...
That's not very polite to the eastern Native Americans, who that's where they live. The Plains Indian lived in the old buffalo hide and the sticks poking up, which are teepees.
Yeah.
So, what do you think the scores are? My goodness, we have a clear winner, and we'll go from first to last, I think. Clive, runaway winner with 1 point. Fantastic. Phil, second with 0. Johnny third with -10, and way out the back there with -26 is Alan Davis. Well, that's it from QI this week, and so from Clobbelob, Philolob, Jobbelob, and Alan Davis the Lobbelob, and from little me, good night. Good night. What kind of music do spiders like?
Well, I reckon they got 8 legs, they'd appreciate a one-man band. Ching doom doom.
And you can catch the next round of QI starting now on BBC4.